your wheels are turning, and you're like, I don't know if I wanna drive this car.
Well, the main thing is to be able to protect down the road, so, you know, if the nightmare happens, and suddenly it, you know, falls to the city, and the roads aren't built to standards, or, you know, there aren't sidewalks, or the drainage is.
Yeah, so those are gonna be things you don't wanna compromise on.
Right, so.
I'd say the fourth part, when we go through this, is not just thinking about today, it's thinking about the future, because you asked Ken, but dealt with our ordinance just from 1971. Step by step, the books that we have to go by. Obviously, from 71 to 2022, or 2021, a few of them were up, but it was tricky, so you gotta think about what might happen in the future as well. It's hard to predict, but put everything out there now while it's open for doing so.
So one of the other things that the planning commission is charged with is the final decision on, well, I should say that, the legislative body, your city council has the power to name streets and assign addresses, but usually that's delegated to an administrator to kind of work with developer, proofread things. Addresses, are they done by the GOK? And then are you putting them into a GIS system, or?
Yeah, I think GIS.
Okay.
And if it's a separate subdivision, they can come up with their road or whatever, and then gets approved by the post office first, make sure there's no federal language that's not supposed to be on there.
Okay.
Goes in front of the board, that's usually, they do that during the pre-plat, or not pre-plat, but the, I think Ken's had it, you know, so somewhere throughout that process with the current ordinance, the board does see it.
But you're the one that locks in the addresses and enters and in the system.
GIS.
Okay. And you see,
do you do it for Florida?
I do, yeah, I'm the only one in the county that's got that right. Actually, that's the only thing that they send over to.
The planning commission approves subdivisions, and that includes the primary plat and the secondary plat. The primary plat has to go for a public hearing before the planning commission and notify surrounding property owners and residents. The secondary plat, because you have to meet the standards in the ordinance, it's administrative, so it does not have to go to the planning commission for approval. You can do it internally by just having staff review things if you choose to. Some communities say we want staff to be the reviewer, but we want the planning commission to ratify it and make that final approval, even though they're not the ones checking the water lines, checking the utilities, making sure the easements are what they need to be. So we just note that the planning commission may delegate that authority to approve secondary plats to the administrator. But the key is it does not have to go for a public hearing. You do not have to notify surrounding property owners, because at this point it either meets the ordinances or it doesn't. There's no passionate out in the meeting or arguing with neighbors that either meets the ordinance or it doesn't.
So the primary plat doesn't pretty much just be the lots, for example, on the site plan basically.
Yep.
Without much detail.
Right, but you're gonna show, here's the roads we're connecting to, here's where current utilities are, here's how it's gonna fit in, and we need all your lot sizes, and so we're gonna need your street standards.
So, and then the secondary does much more.
All the details of that. And then with regard to changing the zoning maps, the planning commission makes a recommendation to the city council, and the city council has the final say on all of those changes. So if you look at all of these rules, planning commission has the final say on primary plats and secondary plats of subdivisions and development plans. They only make recommendations on the zone map changes and if you have PUDs. So certain things are administrative for them, other things they kick to the city council for their final decision.
So the final part for this now, today, if we make a recommendation, it comes back to the city council, this, when approved, will be, the commission makes approval to their own city council.
Correct.
Which is, makes it a lot simpler.
Yeah, it makes a little more sense, it's closer to home than contextual. The planning commission does have the ability to set up various committees. One of the committees, I use quite a bit, it's changed terms over the years. Right now, I'm using the term checkpoint agencies. Sometimes it's called a technical advisory committee. This, for example, is kind of a technical advisory committee. A lot of you know all the technical standards and specifications for city utilities and drainage and things like that. I started using the term checkpoint agencies because it's a little easier to understand. There are certain agencies and groups that we want to weigh in on projects that come to the city so we can make sure they meet their standards. So whether that includes the school board, or a representative from your school district to make sure either a bus is coming through, or is there going to be a bus stop, or do you need a turnaround? Maybe you want to talk to fire and safety, you know, what issues do they want to see dealt with in the community? So, yeah, we have a list of checkpoint agencies who either meet once a month to go over the developments, or maybe they just receive copies of the applications and then reply back to the administrator by a deadline. There's different ways of doing it. We realize everybody's, you know, very busy and doesn't have time to necessarily drive into town and have all the meetings, but you do want to make sure that they have the ability to weigh in. Some of my communities have gone a step further and identified who's going to be members or participants on this checkpoint agency committee. And I've listed a whole bunch of possibilities, could be all, could be not some, but I started itemizing membership because one of the communities I got invited to have their planning commission was serving as the technical advisory committee. And I'm like, you can't have a forum of your planning commission previewing development before it goes for a vote. And I was like, no! Out of the room screaming, but that's what I wanted to do, and I'm just like, you're doing what?
I can't see any conflict there.
No, well, they didn't see the conflict. They didn't understand that, so we agreed and said you could have two planning commission members participating, but it's really for the rest of these folks who are going to be weighing in on development. And you can use this checkpoint agency group to, they can help with your subdivisions, obviously, but maybe you want them to weigh in on zone map changes. How's it going to affect your department? I mean, if you're rezoning something to heavy industrial and the water department says, wait a minute, we don't have water lines out there for capacity, you want that weigh in ahead of time, not when it gets before the planning commission or the city council. You could also have them weigh in on any variances of use or special exceptions that would come before the BZA for the same reason, maybe that there's a problem with that use that nobody realized. And then the Board of Zoning Appeals, their responsibilities and interactions with the ordinance are quite a bit different than the Planning Commission. All they are looking at is anything that deviates from the standards or is creating a long-term non-conforming use, is essentially what the BZA is doing. They're set up very similar to the Planning Commission. There's a certain membership. There's five members. Almost everybody's planning for BZA. They, too, only have jurisdiction inside the city limits. Same thing with quorum, taking official action. They have a chair and a vice chair and a secretary. Taking minutes is the same. Their powers and duties, they handle appeals. So if your administrator says, I'm interpreting the ordinance to apply this way and you don't agree with me, we send it to the BZA to hash it out. If maybe they didn't like something the building inspector did, you know, you failed an inspection, or maybe you feel like the building inspector is bullying me, you can take that matter to the BZA and hash it out and let them make the final decision on that. They handle special exceptions, which means uses that are permitted in the district or provided certain conditions are met. Variances from development standards, if they can't meet the ordinance for some reason, like setback or a height requirement, the BZA would handle that. And then also variances of use. Kind of, to me, a backdoor to the rezoning process, but somebody could walk in and say, I want to open up this grocery store on this residential piece of property. I'm going to keep it small, I'm going to make it, you know, very local, and I'm only going to have these types of foods there. The BZA can theoretically, well, they can actually approve something like that if they wanted to. So something outside of the district. All right, so that's kind of the end of the introductory provisions there. Are there any other questions on that one?
Okay, I tell myself I would not hold it back. So I have one more thing to say, and you're going to say, well, that's stupid. And maybe it is, but why is it called an advisory planning commission and not a planning commission?
You know, it's, they could have called it the purple planning commission or the green planning commission. It doesn't, the term advisory does not mean anything specifically.
Okay, because all the planning commissions I'm in contact with, doing my work, they're just planning commissions, and that's strange. I thought maybe there was some reason that that word was added.
Under state statute, there's area planning law, so there's an area planning commission. There's advisory planning law, there's an advisory planning commission. There's metro law, which is just Marion County and Indianapolis, and they have a metro planning commission. So it's just the term they use. It's, that term does not mean anything about how they function. I was with one group and they said, well, we're an advisory planning commission. We don't make decisions at all. We just advise. And I'm like, no, no, that's not how that works. And so, yeah, under advisory planning law, what's kind of different than the area planning law from what Cameron deals with is it's only for, let's say it straight, it's for cities. Only cities and towns can be advisory plan commissions. Some counties can be advisory plan commissions if they don't oversee other towns. And the main difference in how they operate is the number of plan commission members they have and whether or not they can grant use variances. So Cameron's group in the county cannot approve use variances. So he cannot allow a use to occur in a district where it's specifically not allowed, whereas in town you can't do that. Just a little pitch in the back. But yeah, the term advisory does not mean anything as to how they function. That's a very good question. I probably should talk about that. All right, non-conforming lot structures and uses. Again, these are things that currently exists that for whatever reason are not going to meet any of our new standards. And the whole idea of having this language is to say, we want you to stay, we want you to continue to be how you are. We don't want you to get any bigger though, and we don't want you to pick up and drop somewhere else where you're not permitted. So kind of as a, let's lock you in time, we recognize you, we're not prohibiting you, but we'll keep. So there's two different terms. There's legal non-conforming and illegal non-conforming. Legal non-conforming means that under previous ordinances before this, they were allowed, they got their permits, they fit the puzzle just fine. Illegal non-conforming means you don't fit now, you didn't fit back then, you didn't get your permits, you didn't get approvals, you're still illegal. The fact that we're adopting this new ordinance does not automatically negate the fact that you didn't play by the rules under the old ordinances. Then we get into the burden of proof. Who's going to prove whether it's legal or illegal non-conforming? And we put that on the property owner with the issue. A lot of times, Cameron knows this, you might pull up, the guy says, oh, I've been operating this junkyard for 45 years. And you're like, well, that's funny. I can pull up an aerial map from 5 years ago and you're not there. You came about at some point, and we rely on things like that, or you can get on social media, lounge, but website established, all these things. It's a lot easier now than it was 20 years ago. And I said back in the late 1900s.
And they can now, am I correct, they can mark these on Beacon as such. So if someone was looking at a property around the garden, wants to see a little information about the property, right off the bat, they say, oh, that's a little bit, this is illegal or this. So they can establish that on Beacon now, which is a website we pay for the county for assessments and zoning and all that. So that's an active feature to have.
Who's it showing on Beacon?
I don't know if Lauren's doing it yet, because she works 4 hours a week trying to keep cars. But it's an option that we can do then.
Yeah.
To show that it's not compliant.
Yeah, we can basically say if something's not kosher with that property altogether, we can put that earmark on you.
Many years ago, I found out that the Department of Health that handles cemeteries was using all the old aerial maps to see whether somebody just pulled headstones and made the cemetery disappear because they wanted to farm it and develop it. Scary stuff.
I know farmland's hard to come by, but.
Let's see, under current construction, as long as the permit was properly issued before this ordinance was adopted, continue under the rules of replace when the permit was pulled. We have non-conforming lots of record. There may be some, you know, small lots inside city limits that you weren't aware of, and maybe, let's say it's a 1,000 square foot lot. Your minimum for a new home is going to be 2,000 square feet. Well, as long as they can meet all the other development standards and make it work on the lot, you can recognize that as a lot of record, but, you know, a lot of times it's too small to do anything with. So you just have to look at those on a case-by-case basis. But we recognize there's going to be lots out there that don't exist or that don't meet your ordinance. You could have non-conforming structures, so maybe the structure was built too close to the property line. Maybe it used to be only a 5 foot setback, now we require 10. We would say you can continue to use that house. You can maybe even put an addition on the back that kind of parallels that same setback, but we're not going to let you go 3 feet from the property line. Now, once you're kind of locked in at 5, we're not going to let you go less, unless you go to the BZA and get a variance and make it all legal. A couple of things that we highlighted, and these are some standard language that folks tend to tweak a little bit based on their community. If a non-conforming structure is destroyed, usually if it's burned down, you let them rebuild, and at what threshold would you let them rebuild? A lot of times we let them just use the current foundation that they have, as long as they stay in that footprint, they're fine. And if it's damaged more than 50% of its market value, then that's the point that they would have to come into compliance. So then we also say you have to start reconstruction within 12 months of when the damage occurred. And the structure must be built equal to or less than the square footage of the previous building. So let's say you had a house on a lot that went 5 feet from all the property lines. You're not going to let them go beyond that footprint to build, even though it were considered non-conforming in the past. You still have to say, as long as you put it back the way it was, we're okay, but we're not going to let you make it bigger or go beyond that footprint. The 12-month deadline just kind of says if you're serious about rebuilding, you're probably going to have insurance worked out with that undergoing in 12 months. We just don't want somebody to come and say, well, my property burned down 30 years ago, you got to let me rebuild, and yeah, 12 months to get going on that. I do include a section for non-conforming signs because almost every, I feel like every year they're changing the sign laws, so we have to deal with it in some way. It's easy just to put it in this chapter so we know exactly where to find it. Put the burden of proof on that property owner, chances are if they didn't pull a permit, they're not going to be able to prove the they existed beforehand anyway, so they're usually illegal, non-conforming.
I have a question.
Yes.
So that section C about the non-conforming structures and the 10%. So if my barn that we built 100 years ago, it's all wrong as far as setbacks and whatnot, is it, well, this line is too close to that, that's, but there it is. If it's super important historically, it's, and it burns to the ground, according to this, as it's written right now, are we able to rebuild it?
Correct.
Because it crosses that line and it's too close to that line.
And the current ordinance.
Right, but then you could go to the BZA and apply for a variance and say, your justification is this was a historically significant structure, we would like to replace it with something similar. That would be a great justification to argue that.
Just want to make sure I read it right.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of that's on the, for the county and the lake district, because what was meant to be in the 1560s of fishing shack. Now, 3 feet apart, because now everybody lives in that, in those houses. So there, obviously, there's a lot of that's not conforming to the current ordinance of 7 feet or whatever, because they're a foot or two. But they were built in 1960, so they're still okay. It's when the proper owner commits, well, now I want to add on. There's not a lot of room on Lake and River property, so that's where the BZA gets busy. Every year we get a lot of the smaller properties, especially the L1 district, so.
And I've seen, I think it's up in this area where those lake properties, they have the main house, and then maybe they have a storage barn in the back for the boats and stuff like that, and suddenly they're turning the storage barn into an Airbnb and it's living quarters, and now we want to subdivide it and sell it off. Now you've just doubled the density without...
The garage with rooms upstairs for my grandkids.
Yes.
That's now a apartment complex.
Yep, exactly.
A lot of it doesn't conform.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Get into non-conforming uses of land. Those get a little harder to prove unless it's like a business or something. Obviously, you can set up terms for that. You also have to have a threshold for if it stops or is discontinued. A lot of folks say 6 months to a year. If you stop, we assume you're not going to start it back up. So we want you to come into conformance at that point. We do have a separate clause for agricultural uses. State statute calls that out specifically. You can change from different types of agricultural uses on the property. Obviously, if you were a crop farmer and you got disgruntled and suddenly wanted to become a confined feeding operation, that's a little different type of jump, a couple more hoops you have to go through, but the statute does recognize that farming encompasses many different types of uses and covers them on those properties. Probably something Cameron deals with more than what Delphi, you know, city limits would be dealing with. But if you did happen to annex properties, and you're annexing for development, that there's an existing ag use, this is when that would come into play. You could have non-conforming uses and structures in combination. We try to address those. Again, you're allowed to continue. We have no problem with that. You can change to less intense uses, but you can't jump into another non-conforming type of use or structure and consider making it work. The last little section here is non-conforming zoning districts. I don't see us doing away with a zoning district, but in the future, if let's say you wanted to do away with, let's say the Hoosier Heartland for some reason, all that changed, you still have property zoned to that district. You wouldn't let somebody, another property rezone to that district. You say, look, this is the end of that district. The properties that are there can stay zoned that, but nobody else can have that zone. So we just kind of have that clause for in the event that happens.
So the overlay district was established, this is a
probably a bad example for me to use.
So, and this is a theoretical.
Sure.
Whatever. So, it was adopted by the county area plan, a very small part would be within corporate limits. If we were to establish our planning authority, could we opt out of the overlay district?
You could, I don't know that you'd want to.
I don't either, I'm just, it's a, as I said, it's a hypothetical.
Yes, I mean, it's a district inside your city limits that you now have control of. So, yeah, you could opt out of that if you chose to.
Or do a variance or something like that.
It would just essentially be a rezoning, through the city council.
Okay.
Once you take that eraser to your map, and you're like, this doesn't exist.
Yeah, I don't, I'm not saying that that would ever be on the table, but, it just was a hypothetical question.
Sure.
Something that would, that occurred under, a different, you know, planning and zoning, authority, if you will. Then, if the district's sort of, you're now taking charge of planning and zoning for just the corporate limits, dealing with things that were established under, you know, the county plan commission for your, corporate limits, likewise, so, okay.
But, you know, obviously, that corridor, for example, is a pretty lengthy area.
It is.
And you'd like over continuity to continue. And that's why it's so important in this process to work with the city and the county, work together to, and maybe they're interested in making it even more restrictive or like a different type of product, and we can work together and make it happen. You can rezone it all, the PUP, right, your own ordinance to go with it. Okay, well, we've got two of the 10 chapters already done here, so, I am gonna pass out your homework here. This is a fun one, you can sit at the table with your family and talk about it, and, essentially what I did was I took all of your current zoning districts, and if I changed the name of it for some reason, I noted that in italics underneath it, but I'm keeping the intent the same. Essentially, if we look at residential, for example, you had U1 and U2, and they were both called urban residential. I can't tell from U1 or U2 what the differences are. You call them both urban residential, like, you know, I have to do a bunch of reading. I don't want to have to do that, so.
So what are you doing your homework for?
Well, and there was no purpose statement for which one, and when you get into, say, U1 had a set of uses, U2 said, well, you can do everything in U1 plus some of these, but not these.
And then you have to go back and do U1.
Yeah, let's look at each of these independently. So, U1 was formerly urban residential, I'm calling it suburban residential, so we expect it to be lower density than the other district. Probably not too much difference in the permitted uses, except that the residential 2, or the urban residential, is going to allow multifamily and two-family. Okay, I see how this works. Suburban residential is single and two-family by right. And then when you get into the urban residential R2, then we're looking at this more as a multi-family and two-family development, but with single-family by special exception. So we kind of, they're all permitted, but we really like one to be more dense than the other and have some more housing opportunities. And you'll see that in the purpose statement. And again, these are, after just kind of reading through what your current ordinance says and the types of uses, I came up with these purpose statements to kind of reflect that. I'm not, my feelings won't be hurt if you want to tweak those or change those a bit. The business districts, we have central business. which is, you know, kind of your downtown area. And unbeknownst to me, when I worked on that multi, or that mixed-use district, the central business district already functioned as a mixed use. It called it right out in the ordinance as a mixed-use district, so.
For Delphi.
Right, for Delphi, so they don't need the mixed-use district, we already have one. So essentially things you'd expect to see in the downtown area. And you give a little less density to your local business, which is gonna be serving, you know, the neighborhoods. And then general business, a little more intense, that's gonna be serving not only the city, but also kind of regionally, so the types of uses are permitted a little more liberally. Adding a new district called the institutional district. And these are gonna be things, public uses, cemeteries, churches, hospitals, fire stations.
Schools.
Schools, yep. And the reason for that is while they're usually permitted inside residential districts, if you think of a church 50 years ago compared to what a church is today, they do different things now, and it's hard to say all the residential standards apply to the church when it functions totally differently. So we build this institutional district that recognizes this is more of a commercial use, we have signage standards that match it, the setbacks are gonna be different, open space requirements are different, even though it's compatible with residential use. So we kind of build this separately. We're not saying that those types of uses aren't permitted in the residential districts, but we'd rather see them in the business districts, the commercial business districts, or in this institutional district, so that we kind of know what to expect. Also, if you were to buy a house, and you see next door is this institutional zoning district, you kind of know what to expect. Whereas if there's a vacant lot next to your house now, it could be a house, it could be a church, it could be, you know, all these other things. It just kind of makes it a little more transparent and predictable. Industrial districts, you had two of them. They were just called Industrial 1 and Industrial 2. Now we're calling them Light Industrial and Heavy Industrial, trying to make them more descriptive. Essential differences, Light Industrial, we don't expect to see outside storage of equipment or materials. So. And then lastly, we have a floodplain overlay district, which will follow the floodplain maps. So if those maps change, the overlay district changes. It's all based on elevation. And in this district, for example, it permits everything that's in the underlying district. However, we don't want to see homes in this area. We don't want to see vehicle storage, campgrounds, things like that that could be a problem. And then the Hoosier Heartland Overlay District, I just took the language straight out of the current ordinance and just pulled it into this table. So that's verbatim exactly what you have now. So your homework for the next, so February 16th when we meet again, is kind of go through this list. You know, look at that purpose statement. Does it say what you want it to say? Are the types of uses you expect to see, you know, represented? Are there more we should consider? And then that's kind of what I'll be basing my draft of chapter 2 on. About a week before we meet, I will be getting you a full draft of chapter 2 that will reflect all the setbacks, minimum lot sizes, and it's gonna parallel what your current ordinance says. So we're minimizing the legal non-conforming uses that we expect to see by the end. This is probably the most intense homework you'll have. So. Otherwise, you'll just be getting the chapter, you know, a week in advance and then just read it.
And Deb, can you send this
electronically?
Yeah,
as well?
So that we can get it
most
to the or not.
Yep.
Because I know they would not want to miss the home.
It takes me a little while to go through and put this together, so that's why I wasn't distributed ahead of time, and I wanted to explain what we were doing before we got into it.
So is our homework due a week before, or?
Nope, at the meeting.
A week before?
So, well,
I'm trying to
do it. I'm just because we're reviewing it all.
at the next meeting.
Right.
This is just our little brainstorming idea.
Yes.
The conversation.
Yeah, so that two-page layout I talked about, this is page one of the two-page layout. So then I'll put together page two that has all the development standards to go with.
Oh, yeah.
But if you have kids, this would be a great little exercise to involve them in. You could go to, you know, look at the zoning map and say, hey, kids, this is a, you know, the urban residential district. What do you expect to see here? You know, do you expect to see McDonald's in the middle of your neighborhood? Hopefully they say, no, we are not sure. Well, you could say a small ice cream store in the local district would be very appropriate, or.
No, but Chick-fil-A would be acceptable.
But I'm not real happy with the Chick-fil-A's in Greenwood right now. They really cater into the drive-through and they ignore those dine-in people, so.
And there's 76 cars in the drive-through, I guess.
You're going to get hit in the parking lot, I know. But it is busy. So I'm hoping I will still see everybody again at the next meeting. So, and again, here's all my contact information here. If you want to email, text, call me if you have a question. Don't hesitate to give me a buzz and happy to help. I will do a little plug. The Indiana chapter of the American Planning Association does a little training session called Planning Fundamentals with emphasis on the fun and fundamentals, and we're getting ready to put together some virtual workshops and then maybe some in person again. And we pretty much go over the basics of the Planning Commission and the BZA, the role of the legislative body in the processes. K.K. Gerhardt Fritz and I do a lot of it. Sometimes we have other speakers come in and talk about, we have somebody from Health by Design talks about incorporating sidewalks and activities in your neighborhood to get kids away from their social media and outside playing again, making communities walkable. So I'll forward, as soon as I hear things about when they're going to be offering those, I'll forward those to y'all. But figure I'm the one that helps teach it, so you kind of get me for free right now anyway. So. Any questions, or it's everything you hoped it would be? Couple, I'll put together a couple of extra packs here in case you see folks in person that will include them more. Are there any other abandoned packets? Okay.